our ministry. This is how we spread God's word and his love, through our music and our talent. And our hope is that other people, by seeing us do this, can take their talents and do the same thing. It doesn't have to be music. It can be anything that you're good at. But you have to share it, or it doesn't mean anything. Okay? So that's what we're about, drawing people together. And our love for each other and our love for all of you is something that we feel in the world today is incredibly lacking. So God has asked us to step into that spot. So we don't mind saying it. We're doing this because he wants us to. All right, are we ready?
Yeah.
I'm ready. Shows a month, plus what we're we got a small tour coming up next week, or next month. So we got a lot of music going on, plus Katie has to learn new solos, so we're really busy, so I have to have my words. And I do it with no shame whatsoever. I always say, hey, so, all right, we're going to do Mr. Neil Diamond. When the night returns, just like a friend. When the evening comes to set me free. When the quiet hour that waits beyond the day makes peaceful sounds in me. Took a glimpse from my glass of cigarettes. Took a drink from a glass of old wine. It's hard to hold them in my arms again and feel it one more time. Do you hear it, baby? Do you hear it, baby? Was another time.
Magnificent 88 key creature with hammers that make things loud and soft. The original name for the piano was the pianoforte, which is Italian for soft, loud. Soft, loud. Because before that, the keyboard instruments didn't have hammers, so they could only play just kind of one medium sound, couldn't play louder or softer. And so now we've shortened it to piano, so basically it's called the soft. And it's rarely played soft. So anyway, Robert Schumann was was a very gifted piano player, and he decided in his teen years that he wanted to become a concert pianist. So he was German. So he sought out the very best German piano teacher, which was Herr Wieck, also known as Papa Wieck. And Papa Wieck had three children, and his daughter Clara, at age 13, was already touring all of Europe. She was quite a child prodigy, partly due to her abusive father, who forced her from age 2 to practice 4 hours a day on the piano. And the mother actually deserted the family because she couldn't take the father's abuse. But he was a fine piano teacher. And anyway, so Robert went to study with him, so he moved into their house. He was 18, and he and Clara fell deeply in love immediately, kept it quiet. Meanwhile, Robert was practicing piano, and he wanted to make his hands bigger because small hands is a handicap on the piano. Not that he had small hands, but he wanted them bigger. So he put a device on overnight to cut the webbing in between his fingers to get it to reach farther. And when he woke up in the morning, he was crippled. His hand was permanently crippled, which was bad for Robert, but good for us because he turned to composing and left us tons and tons of beautiful, beautiful music. So his battle to marry Clara is kind of epic in music history. They loved each other very much. And Papa wouldn't let his cash cow go, so he forbade the marriage until finally she was 21. And Clara and Robert went to court, and the judge said, she's 21, she can decide who she wants to marry. So they got married, they had 8 children, and then Robert went crazy and drowned himself. And Clara hit the concert stage again and then promoted his music so that it's remembered. But the piece I'm going to play was actually a song he wrote for Clara before they got married, so it was a wedding gift. And it's called Dedication, and it's based on a beautiful German, very romantic poem that starts out, "You are my heart, you are my soul." And it's written for voice, but then the great pianist Franz Liszt took it and arranged it for just piano solo. As I like to say now, we pianists can play this beautiful song without that pesky singer. So the main melodies. Back in those days, men were much more chivalrous and romantic than they are accustomed to being today. And when they fell in love, they would write poems about their beloved. They would, you know, sing to them, and it was kind of the height of adoration to compare their beloved to the Virgin Mary. And so that's why he included that quote at the end. But things are different today, so I have to explain it. Back then, I wouldn't have had to explain.
Thank you.
And I'm old enough now to know when I'm beat, so I don't try. Which is no reflection on me, really, other than I'm smart. Sure. Very nice, Dean. Let us begin. Oh, yes, yes. This song was taken from the musical South Pacific. And what we try to do with our music sometimes is that we can go through and we can pick through all the songs everybody does. But we like to find some different ones that people don't always do. Because, first of all, I find them more interesting, you know, because I don't know them. And second of all, they seem the ones that are kind of sit in the background are usually the ones that my mother used to play on her record album. So anyway, this comes out of that time. From the musical. Here we go. Some enchanted evening, you may see a stranger. You may see a stranger across a crowded room, and somehow you know even then, that somehow you'll see her again and again. Some enchanted someone may be laughing, you may hear her laughing across a crowded room, and night after night, as strange as it seems, the sound of her laughter singing it. If anyone wants to disagree with me on that, Dawn, if you want to disagree with me on that, you're younger than me and you've got something to learn. Okay? All right. When you're weary,
brings home. When tears are in your eyes, I will dry them home. I'm on your side, oh, when times get rough, and friends just can't be found, like a bridge over troubled water, I will when you're down and out, when you're on the street, when evening falls so hard, I will comfort you. I'll take your
greatest of course being Beethoven.
Of course.
And Franz Liszt was born in 1811 in Hungary, although the German part of the Hungary. I just learned this recently. He never spoke Hungarian. He spoke German. And he was a child prodigy. His father dragged him all around Europe as a kid, making money off of him. And when he was 15, his father died. And he kept playing for another 5 years till he was 20 to support his mother. At that point, he was just sick of playing the piano, sick of doing concerts, and he ran off to Switzerland with a beautiful countess, Countess Marie Dapo, a French countess. And she was very selfish. She wanted Franz all to herself. She didn't want him to share him with the concert stage. And by the way, Franz Liszt was a very handsome man, very magnetic, and in addition to being a phenomenal piano player, and he was the original rock star. When he would walk out on stage, women would stand up, scream, and faint, or they'd throw flowers on the stage, or their hotel key. And so he was quite a phenomenon. So anyway, 2 years he's in Switzerland, holding up with the countess, and then he hears through the grapevine that the concertgoers in Europe are saying, well, we don't miss Franz Liszt anymore, because now we have this new pianist, Thalberg, Sigismund Thalberg, and he's the greatest of all. Well, Liszt couldn't take that, so he hot-footed it back to the European scene to find out what was going on. Well, Thalberg was called the three-handed pianist because he had a technique of composition where both hands would be playing arpeggios, up and down, very busy, and somehow out of the center of the piano, a melody would arise. And people said, what's playing that melody? He must have a third hand. But the trick was in the thumbs, because he would come down with the right hand toward the center, the thumb of the right hand would play a melody, you know, then the left hand thumb, and then the right hand thumb, etc. So it created that effect. Well, Franz Liszt said, I can do that, and I can do it better. So Liszt wrote this piece that I'm going to play. It's called Un Sospiro, which is Italian for a sigh. And it has all the show-off stuff in it. It's got arpeggios, hand over hand, hand crossing, octaves, fast notes. And two times in there it has the three-handed thing. Anyway, Liszt asserted his kingship of the piano very easily. And Thalberg's compositions are almost unheard of today. But this piece that I'm going to play is an absolute masterpiece. It's so beautiful. It's one of the greatest pieces he ever wrote, and very, very popular in the literature. So the melody is really simple. Just a five-note melody. It sounds kind of, you know, like the Chinese baritone here. Take the melody straight up. And for Liszt, that always had a religious connotation, in spite of him being a womanizer for his entire life. He was very religious, very Catholic, and in his later years, he became a deacon in the Catholic Church. He took orders. And people said, oh, Franz Liszt, he's such a showman, you know. He just did that to show off, and now we have to call him Abbe Liszt. And he wears the black cassock all the time and looks so pious. But in fact, from the day he took orders, he got up at 5 o'clock in the morning and went to Mass every day for the rest of his life. So I don't really think he was faking it. He wouldn't go that far. So anyway, yeah, that was like a rising up to heaven to him. That's what it meant. He wrote one of his greatest works is his sonata, which is a 30-minute work that I play. And it's actually a huge description of every man's fight with the devil and God. And the first theme in it is, there's always two themes in the sonata. The first theme is called the devil theme. It's quite frightening. And the second theme is called the Jesus theme. And it rises up and up and up to heaven. So anyway, let's see. So in the beginning, the melody is played by both hands like this. And then there, like I said, there's two three-handed parts. And the second one, which is the best one, the flashiest one, comes after. There's a lot of flurry of notes. And then everything settles down into the melody just being played with solid chords.
Thank you.
back off from his student to their student to their student. I actually trace back in my teacher lineage to their student. So that's the only way, kind of the way he played, has been sort of.
Wouldn't that be cool, like, I'm just there to be a student.
My dream, you know? I hope when I die, I can even have that with me.
Yeah, 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 you take the class, yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
Must have been just phenomenal.
But, the music you can follow, it has to be pretty close then.
There's a pretty wide range of interpretation.
Is that right?
Yeah, yeah. In your tent, if it's pianist, you might play it pretty differently. I mean, kind of ballpark on samples and stuff, but, oh yeah. I've got my favorites and my, not that I think of it, but, you know, they're getting older now, so I just don't like to have a whole lot.
Yeah.
People on YouTube and listen to them and then they're just.
Are you a favorite smoker now? Why are we here to show off?
Hey, if you got it. I got the three part, obviously. It's pretty amazing, but we work very, very hard. Very disciplined, 6, 7, 8 hours a day. I guess you love something and you want to be the best. That's what you do. I learned a lot from her in that respect. Okay, now we're doing something fun, right? Up till now it hasn't been fun. Okay, you want to talk about this?
Yeah, unless you remember what I say.
No, I
don't. This is a real trip down memory lane. This is a medley I put together from tunes that were very familiar to me growing up. And then when I put the medley together, I realized that the tunes originated from 1898 to 1940. So, but I think they're just, we'll see. There's six of them. We'll see how many of you know these tunes. If you know them, like, and he knew them all too.
I don't watch them.
So, I mean, this music is definitely dying out, sadly, but these are great old tunes and a lot of fun.
Okay.
Are you ready?
I'm ready. Are you? Fingers ready?
I'm not ready.
Deep breath. All right.
In the shade of the old apple. those beavers, jeepers, creepers, where'd you get those eyes? Gosh, again, how'd they get so lit up? Gosh, again, how'd they get that size? Golly gee, when you turn those ears on, woe is me. Got to put my cheetahs on. Jeepers, creepers, where'd you get those peepers? Oh, those weepers, how they hypnotize. Where'd you get those eyes?
Bye.
has stolen her heart. Now don't go away, as we sang love's old sweet song on Moonlight Bay. We were sailing along right there. Always look it up. When in doubt. Mm-hmm.
got another answer.
In the shade of the old apple tree.
In the shade of the old apple tree.
That's just what I said.
Did you know that one? How very fair. Yeah, that is good. It's not a good familiar. And then Jeepers Creepers, you all know that
yeah,
one?
Yeah, that was fun.
And then Red River Valley, which is not a folk tune. It originated in 1898 in Tin Pan Alley. And then it was kind of taken over by country singers, and now people think it's an old folk tune, but it's not.
Where did you originate?
Tin Pan Alley. You know, the jazz is in New York.
Yeah.
The Black Eyed.
Yeah. The Black Folk, right?
Yeah.
Black Folk.
The Black Geniuses. And then came, nothing could be finer than to be in Carolina.
Yeah.
I don't know that one. And then, Moonlight Bay.
You were saying, no.
You know that one. And then, you don't know it. Are you not familiar with these?
It's like amnesia. They're like, they all sound familiar, but I'm not quite there.
Yeah. And then what was the last one? All right, just a quick break. I can use it.
Nice job.
All right, we'll check back with you in just a minute.
Well, thank you.